Thank you. Could I ask those who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we will now move on to the final item of business, which is the members' business debate on motion 13087 in the name of Marie McNair on National Epilepsy Week. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Marie McNair to open the debate. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have secured this debate during National Epilepsy Week, and I thank my colleagues for supporting my motion and participating in today's debate. National Epilepsy Week is a time dedicated to raising awareness of epilepsy, the wider challenges that those living with the condition face, and to promote greater understanding, inclusion and support for those living with epilepsy. And that is why the theme this year is Beyond Seizure. In Scotland, there are around 58,000 people with epilepsy, and it's one of the most common neurological conditions in the world by some margin. Despite this, it can often feel to people with epilepsy that their condition gets less attention, and I know many would not know what to do if someone had a seizure in front of them. So it's essential that as politicians we use our position to highlight the condition and work to tackle stigma. So firstly, if you're with someone having a seizure, only move them if they're in danger, cushion their head if they're on the ground, loosen any tight clothing around their neck, such as a collar or tie to aid breathing, turn them on their side after the seizure stops, stay with them and talk to them calmly until they recover, and note the time the seizure starts and when it finishes. Also, it's important to recognise no two people experience epilepsy in the same way. For one person, epilepsy can mean complete seizure control on medication. For another person, it can mean uncontrolled and frequent seizures despite medication. Epilepsy also has various causes. It can be an identifiable cause, such as an acquired brain injury, developing epilepsy following a diagnosis of dementia, genetic causes, and people with Down syndrome, autism, or with learning disabilities are also statistically more likely to have epilepsy. A study across the UK nations estimated that there are 49 new cases of epilepsy diagnosed in Scotland every day. And that same study identified a connection between increased prevalence of epilepsy in areas of deprivation. People living in deprived areas are a third more likely to have epilepsy than those living in the least deprived areas. And this is something that previous studies by other researchers have also shown, according to Epilepsy Scotland. What this highlights is the complex nature of this condition and how it can often be intertwined with other health conditions and social factors like poverty. I commend Epilepsy Scotland's Welfare Rights Service for their work to reduce poverty by maximising people's income. And I back their calls that GPs who charge for completing an NCT 003 form should stop this practice. A free bus pass should just be that, free. I ask the Minister to take an interest in this matter if she's not already done so. The impacts of epilepsy and the challenges it brings span wider than just seizures. It can result in mental health challenges, feeling of social isolation, feelings of stigma or judgment from others who don't know enough or make assumptions. I was struck by this comment in a briefing provided to me by Epilepsy Scotland. They don't know because they lack the education of how to support someone who is epileptic, and when they see you taking or not being well, they think that you have taken drugs. Sometimes they just leave you. This type of stigma can be debilitating and dangerous, so we must do more to challenge it. Epilepsy can also impact sleep and memory, and unfortunately can make it more difficult for individuals to find or remain in paid employment, with only 34% of working age people with epilepsy in employment, according to the ONS. So for those living with epilepsy, social support services provided by charities like Epilepsy Scotland can be vital.
Douglas Lumsden.
the member for taking an intervention and also for bringing this debate today. Because in February, Epilepsy Scotland had to stop in-person support in Aberdeenshire due to lack of funds. Fortunately, a private company stepped in and provided short-term funding so the service could start again just this month. So would the member agree with me that local health boards really need to step up and provide funding for this vital service?
Marie McNair.
Absolutely. So for those living with epilepsy, social support services provided by charities like Epilepsy Scotland can be vital, creating a safe space to discuss their challenges free of stigma and to access important information and guidance. Access to solid social support has shown that it helps reduce use of clinical care due to people gaining a better understanding of how to manage their condition and gaining better mental health and support structures when they get into crises. These social services are essential, but I do understand funding to continue these services can be challenging and would welcome greater consideration at a national and local level for funding for such services. When I met with the West Dunbartonshire Epilepsy Support Group, I was interested to learn from them about the possible positive benefits of medicinal cannabis for those living with the condition, and I'd be interested to see further research in this area and consideration given to this option. Before closing, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank both the West Dunbartonshire Epilepsy Support Group and National Epilepsy Scotland. Thank you to Brian and John of the West Dunbartonshire Group for meeting with me to tell their stories and increase my understanding of epilepsy. The work they do to tackle social isolation and provide support to those with epilepsy is commendable, and they will always have my support. And my thanks to Epilepsy Scotland for taking the time to meet with me and for providing me with helpful statistics and information. The social support services they provide to those across Scotland are vital, and I put on record my thanks also to the CPG on epilepsy in the Scottish Parliament. Individuals living with epilepsy possess an abundance of strength and resilience. They navigate a world that's not often accommodating of their needs, yet they perseverance with confidence. So let us use our Parliament to amplify the voices of individuals with epilepsy, their stories, challenges and achievements. By doing so, we foster empathy, break down stigma and help raise awareness of this condition amongst our society. So I urge everyone here today, whether it's raising awareness on your social media or meeting with constituents who have epilepsy, take the time to do your bit. We will create that inclusive and compassionate country we strive for. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Pam Gozel. Dr Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to begin by thanking Marie McNair for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this afternoon. This week, as she said, is National Epilepsy Week, an opportunity to raise awareness of epilepsy, particularly around the challenges which those living with the condition can face. I'm pleased to be taking part in this debate as convener of the cross-party group on epilepsy. I also do so as someone who has epilepsy myself, although thankfully it has been controlled via medication for many years now. Epilepsy is one of the most prevalent neurological conditions nationally, with an estimated 58,000 people in Scotland thought to have epilepsy. Unfortunately, as Ms McNair has alluded to, it is still hugely misunderstood by many, with its wider effects often underestimated. There remain lingering misconceptions around the condition, some of which are relics of the very considerable stigma that attached itself to epilepsy until well within living memory. And some of this lack of understanding, of course, affects those living with the condition in many ways, including in relation to the job market. According to figures from 2022, as we've heard, only 34% of working-age people with epilepsy are in employment. 61% of respondents to Epilepsy Scotland's national survey last year said that their epilepsy affected their employment to some degree. And much of this comes down to that serious lack of awareness, particularly on the part of employers, in terms of what epilepsy actually is and how necessary adjustments to working practices can often very easily be made. In 2023, I was pleased to be involved in the launch of Epilepsy Scotland's national survey, Epilepsy on the Mind, which examined the impact of epilepsy on individuals and their support network, particularly in relation to mental health. While it is important to say from the outset that epilepsy is not, as it was often assumed in the past, a mental illness, the study showed that 85% of respondents believe epilepsy nonetheless impacted on their mental health, with half of respondents saying they had anxiety and a third reporting that they had depression. Many people living with epilepsy are, of course, not permitted to drive for good reasons. Having grown up in and now living in a rural area, I cannot stress enough what a serious obstacle this can present both to work and to social life. In my own case, I'm fortunate enough now to be able to drive, although it has been commented that perhaps my driver's licence should be restricted in its validity in some way to the Outer Hebrides. But, Presiding Officer, it is important to ensure that those who have epilepsy can access the right support and advice to help them overcome some of the problems around employment, specifically in particular, that was mentioned. In addition to the essential clinical care required by those living with epilepsy, the work of charities, including Epilepsy Scotland, in providing social support is vital for improving the well-being of those with the condition. This involves facilitating access to relevant resources and knowledge, counselling, peer support activities and welfare rights assistance. This work helps relieve pressure from the health service in the long term, with studies showing that those receiving good quality social support can manage their epilepsy better and use fewer clinical and social care services as a result. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, I would commend Epilepsy Scotland and other third sector groups for the incredible work that they do to support those living with epilepsy, as well as spreading awareness about the condition and its effects. This National Epilepsy Week, I would encourage as many people as possible to learn a little more about epilepsy. Everyone can play a part in reducing the misconceptions, which can needlessly and unfairly exclude so many people from the employment opportunities and the social life which are so important for anyone's mental health.
Thank you, Dr. Allen. I now call Pam Gozo to be followed by Carol Mockin. Ms. Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by thanking Mary McNair for raising this important issue through her members' business. I would also like to thank all the organisations and charities for the excellent work they do to improve the lives of those with epilepsy. This is a time for us to come together as parliamentarians to raise awareness and to extend our support to those living with epilepsy and their loved ones. Epilepsy is a condition which affects the brain, causes frequent seizures. Unfortunately, epilepsy is often misunderstood and stigmatised. A report from the Epilepsy Scotland has shown that a third of those living with epilepsy experience depression, 46% admitted to having anxiety, and 54% said that the condition impacted their mental health. According to Epilepsy Action, only 42% of the working age population of those with epilepsy are in employment. While people with epilepsy earn an average of 11.8% less than their peers, as noted by the Trade Union Congress. However, we must remember that epilepsy is the most common neurological disease affecting an estimated 50 million people worldwide. This includes 630,000 people in the United Kingdom and 58,000 people in Scotland. Epilepsy knows no age, gender, geographical location or socio-economic background. While National Epilepsy Week cannot offer a cure, it helps raise awareness of what epilepsy is. The first step to helping those affected is to recognise the symptoms of a seizure and to know what to do when it occurs. We must also use this week to challenge misconceptions and to break down barriers which prevent those with epilepsy from experiencing the joys of everyday life. I would like to use this moment to recognise the work done by local groups such as West Dumbartonshire Epilepsy Support Group, which celebrates its 20th anniversary last year, along with Epilepsy Connections and Carers of West Dunbartonshire, for raising awareness about epilepsy and for providing those living with the condition and their loved ones with the support they need. However, more needs to be done, especially on behalf of the Scottish Government. Karen Albro of East Dunbartonshire, an unpaid carer and a mother of a 17-year-old son with epilepsy, is struggling with getting support from the limited local services. With funding to local services cut, Karen worries that it will be challenging for her son to get through further education and become self-reliant. As mentioned earlier, those living with epilepsy often experience mental health issues. The onus is therefore on health boards to set up a routine mental health screening in epilepsy clinics, and with immediate referral to mental health support when required. Those living with epilepsy are entitled to a bus pass. However, GPs are charging between £10 to £40 to sign an official form that comes with an application for this pass. Public transport is a lifeline with many people with epilepsy, and imposing a fee risks cutting them off from the rest of the world. Therefore, when the Minister is winding up, I would like to hear her announce that this fee will be scrapped. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would like to reiterate my support to all those living with epilepsy, and I am hopeful that this Chamber can unite and work together to a future with epilepsy no longer casts a shadow and stigma and fear.
Thank you, Ms Gozo. I now call Karen Mochen, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Tess White. Ms Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also start by thanking Marie McNair for bringing this important motion to the Chamber, and on behalf of Scottish Labour, welcome National Epilepsy Week 2024, and recognise its importance, as others have said, of raising awareness of epilepsy and the challenges faced by those living with the condition. As this motion states, and others have mentioned, epilepsy is the most prevalent of the main neurological conditions, impacting around 58,000 people across Scotland. I think, therefore, it is right that we use this week to draw attention to the condition, have conversations about epilepsy, and perhaps ourselves have a look at what to do when someone has a seizure, as Marie McNair explained in her contribution. Awareness of how to respond is absolutely key. And at this point, I would pay tribute to the Epilepsy Scotland and local epilepsy support groups in Ayrshire and Arran and across the south of Scotland region for the work that they do. The raising of awareness, individual and family support, provision of care and level of expertise are absolutely critical, and they are deservedly recognised today in this motion. Presiding Officer, I also want to thank our NHS nurses and doctors and epilepsy specialists who diagnose epilepsy, provide first-class health care and family support where required, and also respond in emergency situations, including when someone has perhaps their first seizure. Our NHS, as we all know, is under significant pressure, but the determination of our NHS staff to provide the best level of service is greater now than it ever has been, and it is right that members have recognised their contribution here today. Presiding Officer, I want to turn to Epilepsy Scotland's Beyond Seizure campaign and reiterate their wider points surrounding the wider impacts of epilepsy, as others have done, on mental health, on memory, feelings of isolation, on employment and driving. Epilepsy, as we know, is not simply defined by having seizures. It's much, much more than this. It can completely change an individual's day-to-day life, their abilities, and also their mental and physical health. Support, therefore, must not be restricted to raising awareness of seizures and how to respond, but also the other impacts which may not immediately come to mind for people. Whilst I do recognise the need for Epilepsy Scotland's funding to match the service delivery they provide and extend support the offer. I do believe, as has been said many times across the Chamber, that the Scottish Government have to reflect on just how the third sector is funded. It's easy for the Scottish Government to pin responsibility on the NHS and local government, but in reality, these are bodies that are absolutely cash-strapped as a result of decisions made by governments across the UK. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I once again thank Marie McNair for bringing this debate to the Chamber. It is an important one, and I believe it has achieved its aim of raising awareness in this Chamber, its wider impacts, and the need for better resources to ensure support can be delivered. Epilepsy is a topic we must speak about more. The scale of the prevalence in Scotland and across the UK confirms that, and I hope this week will go some way to achieving this. My party, as I said, welcomes Epilepsy Scotland, epilepsy support groups across the Scotland and within the NHS, and we hope that this helps to deliver some long-term stability in progressing in this area. Can I just thank all my colleagues for their contributions and, of course, Marie McNair again for bringing it to the Chamber. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Morgan. I now call Tess White to be followed by Emma Harper. Ms. White.
Presiding Officer, I also thank Marie McNair for securing parliamentary time to mark National Epilepsy Week. Having experienced a grand mal seizure myself, I wanted to make a brief contribution this evening because it's so important to increase understanding of this neurological condition and its impact on everyday life. And I also would like to take this opportunity to commend Dr. Alistair Allen for also sharing his story with us. Having somewhere to share stories and experiences can be transformative for people living with epilepsy and their carers. I pay tribute today to support groups such as Quarriers Epilepsy Community Outreach, which has groups in Inverurie and Banff in my region, as well as Parents Support Group in Stonehaven. After experiencing my seizure, it felt like the whole world had fallen apart. I was told by my consultant that I may never work again. I couldn't drive, I couldn't get to work, I couldn't go swimming, and I couldn't ride my bike, which I did often. I also, at that time, had to think very carefully as I wanted to have children. It felt like I'd lost complete control of my life and the freedom to live it the way I wanted to. I felt panic and fear as doctors work to unravel the cause of what can be a very complex condition. Fortunately, I was the head of HR, but I know not everybody in employment was as lucky as I am, and I was grateful for my employers at the time to support me, to help me get to and from work. Last year, Epilepsy Scotland, as we've heard today, published Epilepsy on the Mind, a report on the impacts of epilepsy on mental health. It found that among people with epilepsy, as we've heard today, one in three said they have depression, half said they have anxiety, and one in four say they have both. And these are sobering findings, and they reinforce why we must encourage conversations like the one that we're having today about epilepsy. And I was pleased to support Epilepsy Scotland's call during Mental Health Awareness Week for health boards across Scotland to implement mental health screening in epilepsy clinics. And I think that is very, very important. Another finding that struck me in Epilepsy Scotland's report was that 48% of those surveyed were not in paid employment. And I think looking back to my experience, it was so devastating, I could have stopped work, but I was given the support that really did help me understand what the condition was, and I had very supportive employers. So I am grateful for that, as I say. More than 60% thought that epilepsy had affected their employment prospects, and it's true. And across the UK, people with epilepsy have one of the lowest rates of employment amongst disabled people. And when I saw that, that was alarming, and one of the reasons why I felt I had to speak today. I share Epilepsy Action's ambitions for more support to help people with epilepsy to find and stay in work. As a society, we must do better in this regard. One final reflection, Presiding Officer. As co-convener of the Medicinal Cannabis CPG, I've heard some really difficult stories of parents desperately trying to secure medicinal cannabis oil to ease the symptoms of their children with epilepsy. And we seem to be just going round and round in circles on this, and we need to find an answer to it. The UK government has rescheduled certain cannabis-based products for medicinal use. More than 5 years on from this change, we need to address the barriers to prescribing these products. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. White. And I call Emma Harper. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wasn't intending on speaking this afternoon, but just listening to the contributions and reading the epilepsy briefing ahead of the debate that was sent to us by Andrew Lindsay, I thought I would just jump on my feet here. So thanks to Marie McNair for bringing this members' debate to Chamber today. And just as I said, in reading the briefing, I was actually quite surprised about the additional items regarding depression, anxiety, OCD and PTSD. And I know that Pam Gosnell mentioned depression and anxiety, and I think it's really important to do that. And so, and one of the things that came to us in Health Committee in our briefing papers was around raising awareness around anxiety and depression in persons with epilepsy. And, you know, for one of the things that, as a type 1 diabetic, when I go to my doctor's appointments, I think it's about once a year they give me a self-assessment tool for depression and anxiety, because that's higher in type 1 diabetics. And it's something that in my care, I think it's about once a year. So this self-assessment that's used is called the Hospital and Anxiety Depression Scale. So it's a HADS scale. And that's used to assess with numbers 3, 2, 1, 0 about level of anxiety and depression. And as co-convener of the Lung Health Cross-Party Group and the Diabetes Cross-Party Group, we've had discussions around assessment of anxiety and depression in people as well as like people with COPD or in persons in addition with diabetes. So it would be just interesting for me. I want to raise awareness of these assessment tools that can be used, like the HADS, and I want to seek to make sure that if people are making a self-assessment, that they do so and make sure that they know that they need to access a healthcare professional if they do score high on any scale that might indicate that they need to access a healthcare professional. So I would be interested to hear from the Minister any comments around self-assessment, but I think we need to be really crucially aware that should people act on any self-assessment scale, that they know that they should seek assistance and support. So I'd be interested to hear from the Minister what she thinks about that. And I'll end my comments there, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And I now call on Minister Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am delighted to be able to respond on behalf of the Government this evening as we mark National Epilepsy Week. I would like to extend my thanks to all members who have spoken for their thoughtful contributions and to Marie McNair for moving this important motion. As Ms McNair has said, this allows us to amplify the voices of those living with epilepsy. I recognise how debilitating epilepsy can be, and the importance of high-quality, accessible care for people living with the condition. It's been sobering to listen tonight to the wide array of difficulties people can experience, and I agree with Tess White and Dr. Allen that the ability to share stories here can be transforming, and I thank them both for sharing theirs. I want to express my gratitude to our third sector partners for their communication of the challenges facing people living with epilepsy, and for their commitment and desire to work with us to further develop integrated and person-centred care. Yes, of course.
Tess White.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister, for taking an intervention. Would you be willing to meet with myself and my co-convener, Pauline McNeill, to talk about this issue that I raised? There's one mother that has to crowdfund. I think she pays about £2,000 a month to treat the epilepsy of her child. and because you can only get it on private prescription. So, as I say, we've been going round and round in circles. So would you be willing to meet and have a discussion and see if we can charter a way through? Thank you.
Always through the chair. Minister.
I thank Tess White for her intervention. And yes, I would be happy to meet with herself and Pauline McNeill as chairs, co-chairs of the CPG. I think it's fair to say that it has been a productive year since our previous epilepsy debate, and I'm delighted to update the Chamber on progress we're making in supporting projects and developing work to improve the outcomes for people with this condition. Since the introduction of our neurological care and support framework in 2020, we have committed almost £650,000 to projects which improve the health and well-being of people with epilepsy, despite the pressure on Scottish Government priorities. The work funded is wide in scope and has delivered direct improvements in care, such as supporting Epilepsy Scotland to work with NHS Lothian in piloting mental health screening and intervention for people with epilepsy. We've also funded Epilepsy Connections to test a partnership model of delivering dedicated online and phone counselling, and we funded work by Quarriers to deliver community outreach support, epilepsy awareness workshops, and to develop a programme which empowers people with epilepsy to make informed decisions about their own care and increases their capacity for self-management. I'm also delighted that we have continued to invest in the development of a Scottish Epilepsy Register to improve delivery and access to care across the country. The register alerts clinicians to patients who may need a review or care intervention, for example, following an A&E attendance, and seeks to improve epilepsy care in pregnancy. It will also provide crucial data for service improvement, audit and research. The register is a key objective in improving the safety and quality of care for people with epilepsy, and we are currently supporting its further adoption across Scottish health boards. This evening, we've heard a lot, and I'd like to just touch on some of the points that have been raised. And I think I'm just going to touch on the point that you're going to raise. I absolutely recognise that the third sector needs stability and the opportunity for longer-term planning and development. We are committed to developing a fairer funding approach for the third sector. Regrettably, the ongoing economic circumstances present additional challenges, which mean we're not able to take forward multi-year funding to the extent we'd wished in this financial year. However, we will continue to progress fair funding arrangements, including exploring options to implement multi-year funding, helping to enable the third sector to secure greater resilience and capacity. I'm not terribly sure, Douglas Lumsden, if that's the area that you wanted to come in on, but I will...
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. It was this area, because when you were speaking, Minister, it sounds like everything is rosy, but obviously, you know, on the ground in Aberdeenshire, it's very different with in-person support closing due to lack of funds and then having to go to the private sector to try and make that up. So I'm just trying to work out, I don't think it's the multi-year funding that the complaint was from Epilepsy Scotland on in-person support. It was just there was no funding at all.
Minister.
So the Scottish Government's currently working with Epilepsy Scotland to look at their sustainability model. So I hope that gives the member some comfort that we are working closely with Epilepsy Scotland. I think a number of people also raised and noted employment. And I absolutely recognise there is a gap between disabled and non-disabled people in the labour market, and that remains too high. And the Scottish Government remains to at least halving the disability employment gap in Scotland by 2038 from its 2016 level. We have invested £108 million in employability services last year, providing intensive and personalised pre-employment and in-work support for unemployed disabled people and those with health conditions or other barriers to progressing this work. With regards to the bus pass, Marie McNair, Alistair Allen and Pam Gosell all highlighted this. And I can say that my officials are in discussion with Epilepsy Scotland to explore more options around improving access to concessionary travel. The decision to charge for the signing of such forms is actually a matter for the GP practices, because they aren't covered within the GP contract. But we are exploring other possible solutions. This evening, we've also heard about how epilepsy can have profound impacts on people's mental health and the social barriers that it can create. and I'd like to assure you that this Government has a vision of a Scotland free from stigma and inequality, where everyone fulfils their right to achieve the best mental health and wellbeing possible. And I know that members across the Chamber will share this vision too, and as we've heard from many of the contributions tonight. I'm pleased to say that we've committed £213,000 over 2 years to support work by Epilepsy Scotland to improve the mental health, social connectedness and self-management skills of children and young people with the condition. This is being provided through the Children, Young People, Families and Adult Learning Fund. And I note the findings, as Alistair Allen spoke about, of Epilepsy Scotland's 2023 report, Epilepsy in Mind. And we have published a new mental health and wellbeing strategy jointly with COSLA, and it focuses on outcomes with an increasing focus on wellbeing and prevention. Presiding Officer, I'd like to close this debate by thanking those who have shared stories, experiences and contributions today. I know members will need no reminder of the current challenges faced by projects across government, but despite this, I believe we are making substantial progress. But we have got a distance still to go. The work we have supported through the neurological framework has made a significant contribution to improving services for people in Scotland with epilepsy. Our focus now is on building the networks to drive improvement locally and regionally. I'd like to recognise the dedication of those impacted by epilepsy and the professionals involved in their care who are all working with us to make a difference. This National Epilepsy Week, I want to commend the tireless commitment of Scotland's epilepsy charities in supporting people through the physical and emotional challenges their condition brings. And I agree with Carol Mochan that we should also pay tribute to NHS Scotland staff across our health boards. I want to assure you that we will continue to work with those with lived experience, our third sector and clinical partners, to nurture the relationships we have developed and build on our existing achievements to maximise the quality of life of people living with epilepsy across Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.